Harajan, there will be the first introduction. We will introduce ourselves and what we do, and after that we will look at the red team side of the things and the DevOps side of the things, and at lastly we will meet them together in an example, and after that we will look at how can we maintain our automation code base. So we're both security engineers and Trendyol, and member of Blackbox Security and ITCAT. We're frequently blogging at Trendyol Tech, and we're performing red team and zero day research at our leisure time. So what we're doing is we're planning a red team engagement, and with that plan we are designing our infrastructure and iterate over it with our team. And once it's stable, we're automating our infrastructure design using Terraform. And after that, if the operation will take longer than usual, or we will reiterate one of our infrastructure automation scripts, we will create a pipeline for change management so that we remove human error altogether. So the red team rough cycle looks like this. Usually you're doing external reconnaissance, and once you compromise a machine, you do the same on internally until you get domain admin and domain dominance. And after that, usually the company has some target machine and target file to exfiltrate. And until you exfiltrate that file, you continue your loop of reconnaissance and remote code execution. The operational models are for red team are like this. The first one is full scope penetration test. Although it's a controversial one, you can count it as a red team because you have black box scope and you're attempting to gain a foothold into the target and steal the data. So it's really kind of targeted attack. And although it provides a data point about the state of a security program, it needs lots of time and resource. The similar one, but the different is the long-term red team operation. It really needs you to work towards the company like you're an actual attacker for a year or two, and it have advantages for the company that you will map their own network and the key individuals so that they can harden their security posture throughout the time. And the hardest part for a red team is you have to maintain your access over a long period of time. The other is the classic red versus blue war games. It will strengthen the blue team's muscles against the red team activities, to techniques and procedures, and also red team's muscles against the blue team's in terms of they will see how the blue team handle their attack, etc. So the war games are usually in a simulated or some scenario based environment, and they are really good to have time to time within the company itself. And the last one is adversary simulation. In this adversary simulation scenarios, they are based on some APT or mockup scenario based on a realistic timeline. So you're basically imitating some APT attack or some kind of scenario that company would like to assess. So the goal is to exercise that attack without getting identified or discovered by blue teams. So these events are really good for the company because the state and the scenarios are step by step, so they can see where they fail or where they are succeeding at every step. So in the light of our operational models, there is also operation security. It's a term from the military, and it means that denying adversarial information from the opposite side. So as a red teamer, you should be able to deny any information that you may have from the blue teamers on the other side. In the wild, some threat actors have operational security mistakes throughout the time, and let's get the recent errors. First example is just botnet. They discovered and doxed because of the not encrypted their C2 servers and the chat sessions. The other example is Forceful. He's a Russian botnet developer, and he gave up his C2 server used to carry out the DDoS attacks, so he also got exposed. And the last example is the recent one, is IBM researchers found out a huge repository that got exposed due to a security setting misconfiguration. So if you look at these examples, you can clearly see that the security settings misconfiguration and also some error due to the C2 or the other elements that might be have human error is compromising operations. So it happens all the time. So that's why actually we need an automation. Infrastructure design for the standard penetration setup is like this. You usually have some team server and you're directly accessing organization throughout this team server, and usually the team server's assets, IP addresses or domains are whitelisted by the organization for penetration testing to test more clearly. But in the red teaming setup, you usually have different type of servers behind some kind of redirector, whether it would be traffic or Nginx or HA proxy, etc. So you have multiple servers behind the redirector. The reason for that is you can easily build defense and recover your infrastructure against exposures from the blue team. That's why the redirector approach is more blending into the organization's traffic when it comes to the operational side of things. So when we design our infrastructure, we should be able to consider a few things. The first one is the leanness of our infrastructure. Because we want smooth operation, and complicated infrastructure means more maintenance time or more time to more things to look at. So it's the one of the last thing that we don't want. The second is the segmentation. Your tools of choice must be segmented into the according to the functionality, and they must be accessed from the redirector, not to be directed directly because of the exposure risk from the blue teamers. So these three gain us interdependence for our infrastructure. Every part is interdependent from each other. If some of it got exposed, we can quickly destroy and set up again new one. And the network footprint from the redirector is a things to be considered, so that we can imitate some real traffic from our redirector to the company, so blue teams are don't find us that easily. And also the engagement domain is also important. Whenever we plan an operation to a company, we always choose a domain from that company's domain category. We at least you should try to select it that way. And the payload and C2 specifications are important for the opposite side, because it is your operation more truly if you will use phishing. You should be able to consider the three elements when you design your infrastructure, because you might need then some SMTP mail server or maybe third-party service if you will use, also domain fronting if you will use it as well. You should consider it once you're starting your design. And last is access control and request processing. You should always exercise access control for your infrastructure, and more importantly, the request processing, because if you have some kind of request processing mechanism on the redirectors, you can relay the blue team that if your redirector IP or domain got discovered and blue team were to visit that domain or IP address, or were to mmap or some discovery, run some discovery, you can redirect them to or relay them to the actual domain or the website so that you can avoid their work, discovery work. So this the last thing is the one of the most important things when you consider your design. So let's look at the DevOps side of things. DevOps is mainly is creating self-service infrastructure for teams, and since it's self-service and contains automation, it removes human element, and which also removes manual and slow procedures, so that you can work continuously and more lean and fast. So why we're using automation for every red team engagement, since they all engagements are most of the time are unique, you have to plan and design an infrastructure, and you need to set up it from UI or some bash script or some kind of means. And if you do that by hand for every engagement, it becomes more error prone and slow procedure, and it's boring. So we're using automation. So for automation, we're using infrastructure as code. It helps you to define, provision, and manage your infrastructure. So if you codify all of your infrastructure, you can track version changes, also validate changes, and remove human elements from the infrastructure deployment procedure because it will be done from the code that you're writing. So the provisioning and deployment process automation is key in here. For infrastructure as code, there are a couple of tools. Chef, Puppet, Ansible, SaltStack, CloudFormation, and Terraform are common tools for DevOps practices. But why we are using Terraform? Except Terraform and CloudFormation, the other tools are mainly a configuration management tools and designed to manage existing software. But CloudFormation and Terraform are provisioning tools. Although they have some little degree of configuration management capabilities, they are mainly are for provision the infrastructure itself. And as we said, as the other slide states, CloudFormation is mainly for AWS. So Terraform has multiple cloud support, so we are using Terraform for it. And if you couple Docker with Terraform for the configuration management, all of your needs will resolve itself anyway. And also, why we are using Terraform is also have another reason. In DevOps, there is a term called configuration drift. It happens when you maintain an infrastructure over a long period of time. They differentiate one another in terms of the software version, etc. So if you're using Terraform with Docker, you reduce the likelihood of these differences, because the every changes is actually mean a new deployment. And another thing is Terraform have declarative style of coding. We can give an example for that is if you have 10 instances and you have to automate it. In Ansible, you're automating it like this, and in Terraform like this. But if you will have one more instance on top of that 10, you have to rewrite your Ansible to account the count is as one. On the other end, in Terraform, it's 11, and Terraform will take care of the mathematics itself. So you don't have to write new Ansible. You don't need to write useless scripts anymore, because with Terraform you can update your existing one, and it will keep working. So the last part is the some tools require master and agent to operate, but Terraform is masterless because it directly talks with APIs, so that it removes the need of master server and agent, which will lean more, make our infrastructure make more lean. And the design con one of the design considerations that we have is the leanliness. So Terraform also suits with it. And in the light of this, we have three common combinations when it comes to build our and automate our infrastructure. The first one is Terraform and Ansible for provisioning and configuration management. But as I've said, for red team operation, we need as lean as possible. So Ansible might not work in that scenario because it requires master server and also some agents to operate. The other is if you're using some virtual machines, you can use Packer to template your virtual machines and deploy it with Terraform. And the last and our recommended approach is using Docker and Kubernetes to orchestrate your infrastructure assets and deploy them with Terraform so that everything is to be taken care of with Kubernetes and also some all nearly all of the cloud providers have managed Kubernetes service, so you can also take advantage of that and leave the management side for Kubernetes to them. And you can just deploy your Docker with the configurations that you want and leave the management side to them so that you can operate more easily. And let's look at the demo.
Hi everyone, this is Çalar. Today we are going to demonstrate building a red team operation infrastructure in AWS. We choose AWS, but you are free to use other platforms as like Alibaba or Google Cloud Platform or your own private cloud. Our demo has four phases: inspecting scripts, run scripts and build infrastructure, payload execution, and destroy. In our demo, we just create a simple network topology, but you can extend it with your needs or requirements. Let's take a quick look to our Terraform and Helm scripts. In our repo, we have four important Terraform scripts. The first one, VPC TF file, is lets you provision a logical isolated section of the AWS cloud where you can launch AWS resource in a virtual network that you define. You have complete control over your virtual networking environment, including selection of your own IP address range, creation of subnets and configuration of root tables and network gateways. EKS cluster file is let you create a Kubernetes cluster with one worker. In our demo, we deploy Nginx, Ingress, and Metasploit, which managed with AKS. Helm file is using for deploy Nginx and Metasploit to worker. The last one is security group. This file is using for access control of communication server and services. And also, we have a file to see outputs of our scripts for debugging. Let's start building our infrastructure with Terraform. First of all, if you are not using root account, you have to create a user and attach a policy to access AWS services. After user creation, you should add credentials to your profile. Let's initialize our script and validate. It seems everything is fine. Just deploy it. It seems everything is ready now. Let's check status of Kubernetes classes, node and pods. Let's execute our payload. Now we are ready to destroy all infrastructure. Everything is clear now. Thanks for listening.
Now let's look at the maintenance part. So as you see, we are to do validate, deploy and destroy at every stage of our testing. So we can automate it with GitLab CI. And for it, we use init and validate first to test our scripts health check. And after that, we are using apply to deploy it. And if we were to deploy, we should be able to get the state so that we can destroy it afterwards. And after deployment, the last part is the destroy, but it should always work in the pipeline, because if you were having some problems with deployment, some of your assets would get deployed, but some of them are not. And if the destroy stage does not work, these deployed assets will be online all of the time. So we should be use destroy part always in our CI, work always in our CI with the destroy command, and it will destroy our infrastructure after testing, so that we can validate our codes, and we can also see if our infrastructure got deployed correct or not. So main takeaways from our research and the work is choosing correct tools are key, whether it would be some engagement tools or automation tools. You should always choose whichever you are comfortable with. And for every red team engagement, where you're doing some long-term penetration testing or red teaming or adversary simulation, do not make your infrastructure complex. Lean and interdependent infrastructure, try to build, and the domain choice of the things, as we mentioned before, do not make your infrastructure complex so that you can manage it easily. And at last, use automation and CI so that you can test and validate all of your infrastructure, so that you don't have any surprises during the engagement itself. If you have any more, if you have any questions, we will be on Discord throughout the day. You can ask it, and as I've said, we will share the link of the slides in the Discord as well, so that you can also reach GitHub page.